Old Testament reading comes from Proverbs, chapter 28, verse 13. No one who conceals transgressions will prosper, but one who confesses and forsakes them will obtain mercy.
I would invite you to stand as you are able for our gospel reading. It comes from the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, verses 21 through 24. Jesus is speaking here. You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment. But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or a sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or a sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, you fool, you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or your sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother or sister. And then come and offer your gift. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Well, we are continuing our series on seven simple truths about life. These are seven basic rules or guidelines for behavior that, if we master them, will make our lives far richer and far easier. But if ignored, will make our lives miserable for ourselves and for those around us. We began our series on Holy Humor Sunday by looking at he who laughs last laughs best. And then last week we looked at the golden rule, treat others the way that you would like to be treated. Our truth today is embodied by the simple phrase, man up. As a household with three men, two in training, of course, this is an often heard phrase in our home. Man up! One of the boys is watching television and complaining about having to do his chores. Man up is our encouragement. Get the job done. One of them breaks something and then tries to blame somebody else. Again, man up, please. In other words, don't be a wimp. Grow up and accept responsibility for yourself and for your actions. Interestingly, the phrase comes from the rodeo life, the rodeo world, where bull riders would bolster up one another with the phrase, cowboy up. And you can just imagine them sitting on that bucking bull, you know, in the pen there right before the bell goes off and the bull charges out, and they would say, cowboy up, come on, you can do this. From there, the phrase spread to sports. It was generalized to all men, and I understand it is now also being generalized to all people with the phrase, woman up. I don't know, it doesn't quite have the same ring to me, but I get the egalitarian intent there, that's good. Man, but we don't live in a world where we're exactly encouraged to accept responsibilities for our actions, do we? On the contrary, everything in our culture seems to be someone else's fault, isn't it? As Matthew 5 illustrates, the norm in our world is not looking inward for accountability, but rather to look outward for blame, insulting our brother or sister, even those within the church, calling them fools, and far worse. It's almost never our fault in our country, is it? It's our parents' fault, or it's our boss's fault, or it's the government's fault, or the school's fault, or it's due to our genetic makeup, or it's the devil's fault, or it's even God's fault, isn't it? It's anybody's fault except for our own. Everybody blames everybody else. I don't know, for instance, whether you remember back in the summer of 2011 when there was a rare East Coast earthquake. It wasn't serious, unlike the ones we've seen this week, and it became kind of a butt of a number of jokes. They discovered a fault that was running from Washington, D.C. to Virginia, And of course, since it ran under the Capitol, everybody began to name it as Obama's fault. But not to be outdone, Obama said it was Bush's fault. And so it goes. The cycle of blame is never ending. But God wants us to man up, to woman up, and to take responsibility for our actions. Proverbs 28:13 says, "No one who conceals transgressions will prosper." No one who conceals a transgression will prosper. The Jewish people learned this truth the hard way through the exile. For years and years, they denied their social and political sins of injustice and religious sins of idolatry, despite the prophet's best efforts. But like all sin, it eventually caught up with them and reached the point where the Lord decided that the only way that he was going to get this nation to turn around was to experience the consequences of their actions. And so God removed God's hedge of protection, and things went downhill. Jerusalem was sacked. Thousands were killed. The temple was destroyed. The king was tortured, and the survivors were taken to Babylon. It was an absolutely horrific social experience. And yet the Hebrews, to their great credit, learned the lesson. As many scholars have noted, the exile cured the Hebrews of idolatry. Never again did they struggle with other gods. And when they eventually returned to Jerusalem some years later, they had a renewed commitment to be a people of the law and a people of justice. And when they wrote their history, which we have today in the Old Testament, especially in the books of Deuteronomic tradition, they were brutally honest about their history, and they did not hide any of their social or political flaws that led to the exile. Israel, as a nation, manned up or womaned up. And we need to do the same. We need to own our sins and to apologize to those that we have hurt. We need to do this for our emotional well-being as well as our spiritual well-being, because the two are connected. The idea biblically is that we cannot really ask for forgiveness from God unless we've asked for forgiveness from our neighbors. We can't ask forgiveness for God whom we have not seen until we have asked for forgiveness for our neighbors whom we have seen. You can't do it. You can't hurt others and then ask God forgiveness until you first ask God for forgiveness with others. And so in Matthew chapter 5, Jesus says, when you're offering your gift at the altar, and you there remember that your neighbor has something against you, and I think that's interesting. God said, you remember that you have something against your neighbor. Remember that your neighbor has something against you. Leave your altar there. Leave your gift at the altar, and first go and be reconciled to God. And then come back and offer your gift there. First things first, says Jesus. First make it right with those around you, then go make it right with God. And yet I can't speak for you, but I know that I have a very hard time admitting when I am wrong. I'm afraid to look weak or stupid. I'm afraid others will hurt me back. Maybe for you or for me, maybe our egos are too big. Maybe our egos are too fragile. Maybe we have low self-esteem. Maybe we've been criticized in the past and been hurt, so our reaction is that we're never going to be hurt again, so we're never going to say we're wrong again. And yet, we've got to do it. We've got to do it because God commands it. In fact, here in Matthew 5 and in other places in the Bible, we're told that we'll be judged if we consistently refuse to own up. But we also need to do it for our well-being in this world as well as the next. Proverbs 28:13 again says, no one who conceals a transgression will prosper, but one who confesses and forsakes them will receive mercy. Friends, we man up and we ask for forgiveness because it's the only way to obtain mercy, to live at peace in the world around us. A recent study, for instance, compared the behavior of couples whose marriages were long-lasting and successful and fulfilling with those who did not have good marriages and those whose marriages fell apart. You know, one of the most powerful indicators of long-term success in a marriage, it was how often the couples, the man and the woman, said they were sorry to one another. In fact, those folks who apologized on a regular basis were twice as likely to have long-lasting relationships. And woman up. If you've done something wrong, say you're sorry. It just might save your marriage. But the principle doesn't only apply to family life. In another study, Paul Meyer, the founder of Success Motivation Incorporated, discovered that one of the most important success factors in business is a person's willingness to admit when they are wrong. Successful business people regularly admit that they made a mistake. It clears the air, and it keeps the business's issues in front of the business instead of people's personalities in front of the business. In 2002, for instance, doctors at the University of Michigan healthcare system were directed by management to say, this is a gutsy move, they were directed by management to say, I'm sorry, when they made a mistake in their medical practice. Here's the kicker. Once the doctors began to say, I'm sorry to their patients, letters of intent to sue dropped from 260 the year before to 132. Half as many people said that they were going to sue that healthcare system just because somebody simply said, I'm sorry. Legal fees dropped from $3 million in 2001 to $1 million the next year. John, my apologies to you and to any other lawyers who might be here with us in worship today, but Christian behavior just may well be bad for the legal business. This life principle isn't just pie in the sky in the by and by. One who confesses and forsakes their transgressions will indeed obtain mercy, or at least far more often than if they didn't. Their lives will be richer. They will live at peace with those around. But those three little words, three other little words that are correlate to I am sorry, and those are, I forgive you, aren't they, right? That's the flip side of manning up. And it too is hard. Forgiveness takes time, sometimes years. But like I am sorry, I forgive you, is also a biblical mandate. Colossians 3:13, bear with one another. If anyone has a complaint against one another, forgive one another as freely as you have been forgiven. So you also must forgive. Forgiveness isn't an option for believers. It is to be our way of life. And yet, as I said, it is indeed a hard road. So I'm going to give us three little R's. If you like mnemonic devices, these are three pretty good ones that I think will help all of us in our own lives work on forgiveness. Number one, remember your own sins. R, remember your own sins. If you've ever been a victim of gossip, ask yourself, have you ever gossiped or maybe not told the complete truth about someone else? Number two, if you have been let down by somebody, have you ever let anybody else down in your own life? Or if you've never done what the other person has done, have you done anything else that is equally as serious? If you're like me, probably you have. It is harder for us to continue in our anger if we recognize our own fallibility and how much we have been forgiven by God. So number one, remember your own sins. Number two, reframe the other person's actions. Reframe them. Why do you think that that person did what they did to you? Usually people hurt others because they have been hurt themselves. Try to put yourself in the other person's shoes and ask why it is that they act the way that they do. When we begin to see the other person as hurt or as wounded, then we can begin to have compassion upon them and to pray for them. And it's hard, somebody has said, to stay angry at somebody when you are praying. Remember your own sins. Reframe the other person. And number three, recognize the high cost of holding on to your resentment. Study after study shows that unforgiveness raises our blood pressure, that it increases our tendency towards addictions, it reduces our ability to fight infections, and it destroys our ability to simply enjoy life, to live in the present moments. And so we reach a point where we say, you know what? Yeah, what you did was wrong, but I'm not going to let you continue to hurt me. I'm not going to poison my life with this root of bitterness. I'm going to forgive instead. In the end, friends, we don't forgive because the other person deserves it. On the contrary, we forgive because God wants us to heal and to move on with our lives. So there you have it. Man, woman, accept responsibility for your sins. Ask for forgiveness. Forgive as freely as you have been forgiven. If we follow these simple life principles, our lives will be so much richer, as will those lives around us. Bless you. Gracious God, we thank you for this great gift that you have given us in grace, for the gift of forgiveness, for your love and for your mercy, which has been poured out so freely for us in Jesus Christ on the cross. We thank you that by dying, he has forgiven our sins, that by rising, he has raised us to new life. And now we pray that as recipients of such a great grace, we might ourselves live in grace, that we might live in forgiveness, that we might own up to what it is that we have done in our lives, that we might be humble people, that we might be willing to admit